Hello everybody, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we are going to see the news analysis for 3rd January 2019. So these are the 8 news which we are going to see for today's prelims analysis. So the first one is respect to the places in news, which is Morocco, an African country. And second one is respect to the skill development for minorities, which comes under the National Skill Qualification Framework of Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. Third one is pertaining to Yarn Bank Scheme, which is the initiative of Ministry of Textiles. And the fourth one is about the Rashtriya Yuva Sashakti Karan Karyakram Scheme, which is an initiative of Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. And next one is about the high level committee to be constituted for the implementation of Clause 6 of the Assam Accord, which is signed in 1985. And next one is about the exotic tree species and its impacts on the Western Ghats grasslands. And seventh one is about the recent mine deaths and related mining act of India. And eighth one is from the lessons of Kerala, which is pertaining to the primary healthcare services under the Astana Declaration, which India has signed. So the first article for today's analysis is places in news, which is Morocco. So this has been taken from PIB. The news related to is that a memorandum of understanding has been signed between India and Morocco on cooperation in the cyber space. So for prelims perspective, we have to learn the geography of Morocco. So Morocco is an African country which is lying on the northwestern end of Africa. Okay, it is in the north, it is bounded by the Mediterranean Sea for a part, and in the western side it is surrounded by the Atlantic Ocean. And in the north, it is the Strait of Gibraltar, which separates Spain and Morocco. And this Strait of Gibraltar is under the control of UK. And it has to be noted that the Atlas Mountain stretches from Morocco and it goes on to Tunisia. The famous river which flourishes through this Morocco is Moulouya River. And the capital of Morocco is Rabat, which is situated on the coast of the Atlantic Ocean. And one more thing, the Sahara Desert has also been starting from Morocco, and the Canary Islands, which is under the control of Spain, is located west of this Morocco. And one more thing to be very importantly noted is this Marrakesh, where numerous international agreements and international conferences have been taken place. And one has to note that this Marrakesh agreement has only led to the establishment of WTO in 1995. And also in this Marrakesh only, the COP22 of UNFCCC has took place, and it discussed about the outcomes of the COP21, which is the Paris Agreement, and the deliberations which were underwent in this Marrakesh COP22. Has led to the framing of the guidelines in the recent Katowice summit, which is the COP24 of UNFCCC. So the next article is about the skill development for minorities, which is under the National Skill Qualification Framework of the National Skill Development Corporation. And this article has been taken from PAB. The skill development programs for minorities will be undertaken by the Ministry of Minority Affairs and not by the Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship, even though it is coming under the National Skill Qualification Framework. So we have to see what are the schemes for skill development of the minority that has been implemented by this ministry. The first scheme is about the SECO or KAMAU. In this, placement linked skill development will be imparted to the minority youth, where the skill development will meet the current economic and market potential trends. So upon implementation of this program, the minority youth will be able to have a self-employment or will be underemployed in some organized sector. So the next scheme is about the upgrading the skills and training in traditional arts and crafts for development. So under this scheme, the already established and famous arts and crafts made by the minority groups will be preserved, and it will be imparted to the minority youths for its importance. And through this scheme, the traditional skills of the master craftsman will be updated, and capacity building on this platform will be imparted to the minority youth. Apart from this, this scheme is also enables to enables for the documentation of the identified traditional arts crafts of the minorities. One more scheme is about the Nyaya Menzil, wherein which the minority youth who do not have a formal school leaving certificate, which means the school dropouts and those minorities who have been educated in informal schooling institutions like madrasas, will be imparted the formal way of education and skills. So through this Nyaya Menzil, the government is implementing this formal way of education and skills to the minority youth. And next is about the Maulana Azad National Academy for the Skills. So this Academy for Skills provides an all India level of training framework based on the PPP model, which is the public private partnership model, having tying up with the local, national and international training organizations to the minority populations. So this will be in line with the emerging market demands, so that the minorities could also learn the skills and they can be self-employed or be employed under any organized sector. So all these skill development schemes, though implemented by the Ministry of Minority Affairs, will come under the National Skill Qualification Framework of the Ministry of Skill Development. So we have to see what is this National Skill Qualification Framework. Before this, we have to know there is one implementing nodal agency under the Ministry of Skill Development, which is the National Skill Development Corporation. So this National Skill Development Corporation will be aided by the National Skill Development Agency, which will coordinate and harmonize the skill development schemes. So though it may be central schemes or state schemes, which will be framed into this National Skill Qualification Framework, and this will be coordinated by the National Skill Development Agency, and that will be implemented by the National Skill Development Corporation. So we have to note that this framework will be designed by the National Skill Development Agency and it will be implemented by the National Skill Development Corporation under the Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. So for the inclusive skill development, this National Skill Development Corporation has taken some initiatives for imparting the skill development under the corporate social responsibility. So by this, the government is not only responsible to impart the skills, and also the private agencies, under its corporate social responsibility, it can implement the skill development programs for the targeted populations. So this will also include the disadvantaged and the marginalized communities. So the next article is about the Yarn Bank Scheme, which is an initiative of Ministry of Textiles, and this article has been taken from PAB. As we all know that the textile sector of India has its roots in ancient India itself. The trade and commerce related to textile industry of India has been monopolized even before British rule. So to enable the growth of the sector, the Ministry of Textiles under the Government of India has taken a major initiative in the name of PowerTex India scheme to promote the textile industries. So one such scheme is the Yarn Bank scheme. Under this Yarn Bank scheme, the government is trying to benefit both the consumers as well as the producers by eliminating the middlemen. How? It provides a interest-free corpus fund to a special purpose vehicle. So this special purpose vehicle may be a consortium of the producers. So this special purpose vehicle will purchase the cotton or silk from the farmers at a best deal and it will sell it to the manufacturers. So this establishment of a special purpose vehicle will eliminate the middlemen and the local suppliers brokerage charge. So other such schemes like community facility centers and Pradhan Mantri credit scheme for powerloom weavers, solar energy scheme for powerlooms and other such schemes are incorporated under this PowerTex India scheme to benefit the weavers and enrich the textile industry of India. So the next article for our analysis is about the Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram scheme. So this scheme is under the initiative of Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. So this article has been taken from PIB. For the development of youth, the government of India has taken many steps since independence. There were 10 major schemes up to 2015-16. But in 2017, the Department of Youth Affairs have consolidated these 10 major schemes under one umbrella scheme, which is the Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram scheme. So under the 10 major schemes, Eight schemes are grouped into this umbrella scheme of Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram scheme, and two separate schemes, which is the National Service Scheme and the Rajiv Gandhi National Institute of Youth Development, are kept separate. The scheme beneficiaries are the youth in the age group of 15 to 29 as accorded in the National Youth Policy of 2014. So we have to see what is this National Youth Policy of 2014. So this National Youth Policy of 2014 is also been an initiative of Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports to enable the India's youth to realize their dreams. So this policy envisages a product workforce through education and skill training and entrepreneurship. So by this, the Ministry of Skill Development and Ministry of Youth Affairs has a collaboration to implement this National Youth Policy. So apart from this, for the healthy living of the youth India, the sports as a way of life and healthy generation is also being emphasized under this National Youth Policy. A strong social value is also being inculcated into the minds of the young generation, and thereby a sense of community service have to be rendered to the nation. Apart from this, the scheme is also focusing on the participation, which is the community participation in governance. What is this all about, the Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram scheme? So the schemes related to the youth development and youth affairs are put under this umbrella scheme. As I said earlier, the two other schemes that have been separated from this umbrella scheme are the National Service Scheme. So this National Service Scheme is a central sector scheme where the funding will be provided by the central government. This scheme provides an opportunity to the student youth India to take part in various government-led community services, activities and programs. So the next one is about the Rajiv Gandhi National Institute of Youth Development. So this is an apex national level body which will be implementing the schemes related to the youth affairs and development of adolescents and youth of the country. So this National Institute of Youth Development was set up in 1993 under the Societies Registration Act. So this National Institute will implement all the schemes related to the youth affairs and development. So the next article is about that. The cabinet has approved to establish a high level committee to implement the Clause 6 of the Assam Accord. So this article has also been taken from PIB. As we all know, there was a 6-year agitation in Assam by the All Assam Students Union in 1979 demanding for identification and deportation of the illegal immigrants. As a culmination of this protest, government has decided to sign the Assam Accord between the Assam Student Union and the Government of India. So this accord was signed in the 15th August of 1985. So under this Assam Accord, there was a clause which envisaged constitutional, legislative and administrative safeguards for the Assamese, which will be provided to protect, preserve and promote the cultural, social, linguistic identity of the Assamese people. So even after 35 years of this Assam Accord, this clause 6 of the Assam Accord is not yet been implemented. So in order to implement this clause 6 of Assam Accord, the cabinet has framed a high level committee to come out with the guidelines for the implementation. So here is the history of the Assam Accord. As I said, in 1985, this Assam Accord was signed. In 2016, the Citizenship Amendment Bill spoils the nature of the Assam Accord in the way that the illegal Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist, Jain, Parsi and Christian migrants shall be granted the citizenship. So this violates the Clause 6 of Assam Accord, which states that preservation, protection and promote the cultural, social, linguistic identity. But for the first time through this 2016 Citizenship Amendment Bill, the government has taken religious reasons as for granting the citizenship. So to resolve this conflict, government is under pressure to implement this Clause 6 of Assam Accord. This high-level committee, which will frame the guidelines and implementation procedures, the composition and terms of this high-level committee will be issued by the Ministry of Home Affairs. The cabinet also approved a number of measures to fulfill the outstanding issues related to the Bodo community. This Bodo community forms an integral part of the state of Assam. So for them, a Bodo Accord was signed in 2003 which resulted in the establishment of the Bodoland Territorial Council. This is established under the 6th schedule of the Constitution of India. So under the 6th schedule of Constitution of India, it tries to protection of the scheduled areas and governance of these scheduled areas. So under this, Bodoland Territorial Council was established. So the next article is about the exotic trees eating up the Western Ghats grasslands. This article has been taken from Hindu. As we all know that the Western Ghats are one of the biodiversity hotspots of world. So in this biodiversity hotspot, the threat is mainly the exotic invasive trees. This was identified by a research made by the International Journal Biological Conservation. So they say that the major concern is the exotic invasive trees like pine, acacia and eucalyptus, which has been planted for commercial purpose by the British, are the reason for the devastation of the Western Ghats grasslands. Though this plantation of pine, acacia and eucalyptus has been ceased in 1996, still these exotic trees are acting as an invasive species for the local grasslands. The satellite images from the Baba Budan hills of Karnataka to Tamil Nadu's Asambu hills has revealed that 60% of the Shola grassland have changed and also 40% of the native high elevation grasslands have disappeared. So here we have to note what are these Shola grasslands. Shola grasslands are nothing but stunted evergreen Shola trees in the valleys. It is nothing but the stunted evergreen trees in the valleys located between the altitude of 1600 to the 2000 meters from the mean sea level. So these Shola grasslands are exclusive to the Western Ghats. So if there is any disturbance in these Shola grasslands, it may be a threat to the other fauna and flora species depending upon these Shola grasslands. So there will be an imbalance in the ecological equilibrium causing multiple threats to the devastation of the Western Ghats. So these ecosystems get badly affected due to the invading alien floral species. So these invasive alien species are non-native species posing a serious threat to the native biodiversity. So these invasive species will not allow the local species to grow independently. So what are the steps taken by the government so far to eradicate these invasive alien species from the Western Ghats? So the first step is that, as recommended by the Gadgil Committee and the Kasturi Rangan Committee, ecological hotspots have been located in the Western Ghats. Apart from this, the Forest Department has taken measures to stop the invasive species by removing the eucalyptus and wattle, which are termed as the exotic species, in the reserve forest of Nilgiris and Kodaikanal. So these initiatives of the government should be proactively undertaken in order to protect the Western Ghats grasslands and thereby sustain the ecological equilibrium. So the next article is about that India records 377 mine deaths in 3 years. This article has been taken from Hindu. In a recent report that was produced by the Labour and Employment Ministry in the Lok Sabha stated that about 377 workers have been killed in mining of coal, minerals and oil. Among this, coal mines have accounted for the highest number of casualties. So in order to curb this, the government of India has taken several steps. The historical precedence for curbing this mine death is dated back to 1897, where the first major disaster happened in the Kolar gold fields of Karnataka. So following this, the government has formulated the 1901 Mines Act, which was amended over days by, and the 1952 amended Mines Act still frames the rules and regulations for curbing this mine deaths. So what is this Mines Act of 1952 proposes? So this Mines Act of 1952 covers all mines which is extended over the country except the mines present in the state of Sikkim. This Mines Act is also inclusive of the offshore mines which is located within the limits of the territorial waters. So under this Mines Act, the government has established the Directorate General of Mine Safety, who will be responsible for the occupational safety, health and welfare of the persons employed in the mines. So this mine safety will be coming under the Ministry of the Labour and Employment. So as we all know that under the Constitution of India, safety, welfare and health of the workers are coming under the Union List number 55, and the objective is regulated by the Mines Act of 1952. So the last article for our today's analysis is Lessons from Kerala, pertaining to the implementation of primary health care services. This article has been taken from Hindu. It shall be noted that in last year, the Astana Declaration was signed between the countries, wherein which these countries committed to give an efficient primary health care services to its citizens. This Astana Declaration is nothing but a reaffirmation of the Alma-Ata Declaration of 1978. This implementation of primary health care services can be taken cue from the Kerala government's Aaradhram project. So it is an ambitious project in the healthcare sector that envisages the radical changes in the field. The government has designed various strategies to provide effective healthcare system with better infrastructure and quality services. Under this Aaradhram project, Kerala government has delivered a patient-friendly quality healthcare services in the government hospitals and also in the district and taluk hospitals. Developing primary health centers into family health centers will enable the efficient implementation of the primary health care services. This primary health centers was also reinforced in the central government's initiative of Ayushman Bharat. So to meet the healthcare needs of all members of the family, provides preventive, promotive and rehabilitative health care interventions of the local community. When fully functional, this will enable a web-based appointment system, patient reception and registration. So it should be noted from the Kerala's Aaradhram project, proper allocation of funds has to be provided by the central government to implement its Ayushman Bharat scheme. Apart from this, specialized training and experienced practitioners has to be recruited in the primary health centers to target the local community. Coming back to this Astana Declaration, it aims to meet people's health needs across their life course through comprehensive preventive, promotive, curative, rehabilitative services and palliative care. So these primary health services include vaccination, screening, prevention, control and management of non-communicable diseases and communicable diseases as well. Apart from this, other cares and services pertaining to the primary health of the people.